In a great history spanning two centuries, Stoke City Football Club have provided memories to last a lifetime. Now the modern generation can add its own chapter to the history books. From those far-off golden pre-war days of baggy shorts and lace-up footballs, through the swinging 60s and into the 90s, Stoke City supporters have had something to shout about. In a remarkable historical twist, Stoke have now taken the Division II Championship every 30 years this century. 33, 63 and now 1993. Nice of the powers that be to redesign the Football League with the Victoria ground in mind. So settle back, enjoy this special souvenir and a season to celebrate. The 1991-92 season ended with that high at Wembley, but the one goal that Stoke City and their supporters really wanted to achieve eluded them on that disappointing night against Stockport County in the semi-final of the playoffs. So all of those hopes towards promotion in the end were failed. And so we look towards the new campaign with perhaps renewed hope. Wembley was a great occasion. One hoped that Stoke City would be able to build on that. Well, Lou Macari worked hard with the players during the summer and new signings came in. The likes of Graham Shaw from Preston North End as Tony Ellis went the other way. Graham Harvey from West Bromwich Albion and, of course, Kevin Rooster Russell from Leicester City. And so there was a new sort of optimism at the Victoria ground. Could Lou Macari and his side build on the previous season's achievements? And so there was a lot of optimism in the air as we all trooped off to Humberside on that sunny opening day at Hull City. Well, despite all of the pre-match hype and build-up, it really wasn't Stoke City's day on that sun-blessed opening day at Boothroyd Park. Early opportunity here for Paul Ware, though, with his arm in plaster, just the wrong side of the post. Stoke failed to find the target, and that proved their undoing, even though Kevin Russell broke clear on his own down the middle here. Again, though, the woodwork denied him. In the end, it was the Tigers that came up trumps with this late goal from Paul Hunter. His first for 2 years, would you believe? And so, 3 days later, it's off to Deepdale, Stoke City looking for their first win. Here, Mark Stein opens his account, the first of many, of course. Stoke then hoping that this is to be their first victory, but it wasn't to be. Preston, on this plastic surface, hit back with an equaliser. Scrambled home from close range. But Preston set up an advantage going into the second leg of this League Cup tie, and yes, you've guessed it, Tony Ellis scores their winner at Deepdale. But Stoke fans didn't have to wait long for their first home victory. It came against Wigan, and after two matches out with suspension, Wayne Biggins rises first, last year's hero, off the mark this time round after 7 minutes. Stoke here pressing forward, Biggins again linking up with Steen, and a shot coming in from Steve Foley, though, parried by the goalkeeper. Rooster with a corner. Flicked header, and it's off the line for Sanford that time. And eventually, Wigan scramble it clear. But the home fans had a bit of a nervous twitch towards the end of the game, just after half-time. Tremendous strike there from Griffiths, put them back on level terms. But Merseyside midfielder Steve Foley capped here a great, excellent individual performance with a close-range header, a good day for him.
Finds Russell. Russell through to Biggins. Biggins has Steen with him. Here's Steen, a shot! Oh, and a goal! absolutely delighted with that. Steen's had one or two chances. Biggins and Steen combine again, and possibly the most acute angle that Steen has found all night. But what a shot, a perfect shot. Biggins lets it go, a header, oh, goal! Two players made the run to the near post, Steen and Biggins, they left it to the big fella, he rose, and Farnworth could do nothing. Russell with the corner. Farnworth again stays on his lock. That's a back pass technically, Biggins again, a chip! With just seconds to go, Wayne Biggins ineffective, and now he's scored two goals. 4-0 on the evening, 5-1 aggregate.
5 matches into the season now, and Stoke still looking for their first away victory. It takes them to meet an old familiar face, their former manager, Alan Ball, but not the best start at Exeter, as the home side take the lead. Ronnie Jepson, a former Potterer's favourite there, snatching the first goal. Now that looked like a cross to me, but Steno will claim it as one of his many goals. 1-1 at this stage. Well, if there were doubts about the first one, there's no doubting the intention of this second one, as Stoke begin to sense victory. Pressing forward, Steen free again, and a lovely lob to beat the Exeter City keeper hands down. So 2-1, but X's are not finished, and they actually snatch a late point with a late equaliser. Bit of a mix-up in front of Ronnie Sinclair's goal, and in it goes. Into September now, and Stoke City still looking for this elusive away victory. But after this, there were great things to come. Mark Stein, though, sets up a great start for Stoke at Valley Parade with that strike. He's already got off to a cracking start, as Stino. As we know, his story was to be an impressive one. But Bradford emerged the strongest. Frank Stapleton's side getting back on level terms. Great strike from their number 7 on the left-hand side of the goal here. Bradford made a good start to the season, in fact. You'll remember they were front runners for the first few months of the campaign. And there's a second for Paul Jewell. And coming up in just a moment, Lee Duxbury scores the third. A 3-1 victory for Bradford. Stoke not living up to their pre-season tag as championship favourites at this stage. Well, at the very start of the season, Stoke City really didn't justify their tag as pre-season championship favourites. An opening defeat at Hull City, in fact, 3 defeats in the opening half dozen games or so. A 3-1 defeat at Bradford as well. Who would have believed then that the following 26 games would see Stoke City unbeaten in the league? Let's hear how Lou Macari, the Stoke manager, saw that start to the season.
I think my thoughts were of a high expectancy amongst the support because we got to Wembley, because we won the cup, because we just got beaten in the playoffs. I probably think they'd every right to expect a good league campaign from us the following year. I didn't like that prospect because I thought it was going to put the players under a little bit of pressure. The players we've had here, or we've got here even at the moment, I felt that they could well do without that pressure. I didn't think they were the type of people that could really cope with it. It was going to be difficult enough to go into a league campaign and win the games that you want to win to get to the top without that added pressure. But going with a little bit of success like we had at Wembley obviously goes with that pressure, and when you're at the top you've got to, you know, realise you've got to live with that. So there was a high expectancy, and that was probably the only thing I wasn't looking forward to come the start of the season.
New arrivals as well, new signings?
I was more concerned about people who are going to exit. You know, sometimes with success goes higher demands from players, thinking all of a sudden the club has hit the jackpot in terms of finances, and you tend to find at most football clubs that your biggest problem at the summer when contracts are up is keeping the players that you've got, especially if you won a competition like we did. And of course I did face that problem with one or two, but and when it materialised that one or two people left, everyone probably expected that's going to be the downfall of the football club.
So several players go out, but obviously, importantly, the fans want to know who's coming in, and obviously you thought that you'd strengthen your squad well enough during the summer.
It's difficult to strengthen a squad because nowadays every player's looking for his fair share of a payday, and when you're in the position that we're in, which is a little bit bleak in terms of finance, you're not in the driving seat in terms of satisfying players, and one's got to accept that nowadays that probably means the difference between players coming to your club and not coming to your club. But I had to bring people in. I had to do the best I could in terms of what I could offer them. We got players in. I think we got players in more so from the fact that players left. If we hadn't have got rid of some players, I probably wouldn't have been in a position to bring anyone in. And I think it's fair to say over a season, regardless of what any player that you bring in does for you in terms of how great he's been or how poor he's been, they all do their little bit throughout a season and they all contribute to you winning the championship.
You haven't mentioned any names yet, but maybe that's not your philosophy.
I don't think it's right to pick people who have come in and done well for you and other people that have come in and haven't done so well. I think as a manager you realise that before they even come to the club that some are going to hit it off and others are not. And I think the safest way to sum it all up is that they've all done a little bit for us, because if, you know, without them all doing a little bit, we wouldn't have won a championship.
Can I just point one name out, though, one that was obviously a concern to most supporters, and that was Wayne Biggins, who ummed and ahed about signing or moving for quite some time. Eventually he left, and a lot of supporters obviously were quite concerned about that.
Yeah. I was never concerned about it, because I think it'd be fair to say if I wanted him to stay, and I desperately wanted him to stay, he'd still be here. I had my feelings why maybe it'd be better that he moved on. I took a chance. At the end of the day, he probably wanted a little bit more money somewhere else, or wanted some more money, wasn't going to get it here. And at the end of the day, took X amount of pounds from the club he went to. If I'd have been him, I would have probably thought it was a poor move. But then, you know, that was the end of the season for us, according to a lot of people. I wouldn't have let him go if I thought it was going to be the end of our season. Hindsight, people always say, well, if he'd have been here, we'd have done this. And people throughout the season said, well, if Wayne Biggins had been here, we'd still have done this and we'd have done that. People said Mark Stein's never going to score another goal, which was utter garbage. You know, it's Wayne wasn't the type of player that actually I didn't think contributed to the rest of your team performing. He was an individualist where on the day, if he was on song, he'd bang in a couple of goals, he'd win the game for us. But in terms of a team man, I probably didn't feel that that he was that type of player. And because of that, I felt we could afford to let him go.
And so you approached the new season, favourites. I don't know whether in your mind you were favourites or not, but away you went for the first game of the season.
No, I didn't really think we were favourites. I spent my preparation for the season was 6 weeks in a court, which wasn't ideal from my point of view. Leading into the football season, I didn't really think we were entitled to be favourites, simply because I just had a feeling that previous managers had tried here to win a championship and it hadn't materialised. In my own mind, I probably felt that this was an FA Cup or a Rumbelows Cup or a Littlewoods Cup, whatever it is at the time. That type of club, auto glass as it proved, you know, we get to Wembley, we win the cup. And I definitely did feel that we were that type of football club. A bit like, obviously, Manchester United have been in the last 25 years. Always round about Wembley, always capable of getting to a cup final, but never having that resilience and steel to, go through a league campaign of 40-odd games and be worldly champions. That was my biggest fear. I did feel that I had to sort of get rid of that tag that haunted this football club of not being a resilient type football team and a resilient type football club that can go on and win a championship. Because of that, I probably thought at the start of the season might sneak into the promotion race, might get into playoffs at the end of the year, but if I can win that championship, you know, we'll have done bloody well. And we have won it, and I do regard it as probably one of my best achievements at a football club.
In fact, it didn't start the way you wanted it, did it? And in fact, the first result at Hull was not typical of the season, of course, because you lost very few games. How big a setback is it, we've asked this question before of people, to lose the first game?
I'm never worried about the first game, and I'm never worried about the first half a dozen games, because not just ourselves, Port Vale, who are up there, possibly going to be promoted, or Bolton Wanderers, similar starts to us. Difficult to explain sometimes why, but I think the pressure even getting into the first game of the season was just a little bit too much for us. But analysing the game at Hull, that you've got to do sometimes after it, we didn't come away with any great fears of what lay ahead, because on the day we'd been by far the better side. We should have won the match. but we just didn't. And in the opening day of the season and in the opening weeks of the season, that happens to a lot of football clubs. And I even think, funny enough, it happened to Manchester United. I think they lost their opening game of the season and then didn't have the best of starts. Really, it means nothing. It doesn't throw any light on what the season holds for you.
Yes, definitely. I waited my time to get into the side after having minor up and whatever, and getting a full chance at Hartlepool, which isn't a nice place to go anyway, and to score an early goal, which I think was after something like 10, 15 minutes, was very satisfying, yes. But I think on the whole, the best goal I've scored this season was actually for Bournemouth against Mansfield, which just flew in top corner.
Well, Bolton Wanderers were to prove late and successful arrivals on the promotion scene, of course, and there's little to choose between the two sides here at the Victoria Ground early season. Rooster Russell almost testing the goalkeeper on this occasion, but the goalkeeper saved by the woodwork there. Well, Wayne Biggins at this stage still a Stoke City player. More on that to come later. Here an effort just saved by the Bolton Wanderers keeper Keith Branigan again. Well, Stoke played a five-man defence, seemed to prove effective. Despite this effort from Russell, though, the game remains 0-0. Well, still no away win, but Mark Stein set Stoke on the right road with this goal at Home Park. But after the game, Stoke still 16th in the table as Alan Walker, a defender, scores for Plymouth to secure the 1-1 draw. And to the Victoria Ground, the third successive draw. Good start by Stoke. Sanford in the very first minute, somehow, eventually, with a helping hand, scoring Stoke's opener. Stoke now into their unbeaten run, a run that eventually was to secure the championship, really. But here, Ray Wilkins' brother Dean maybe shows his brother how it should be done from 20 yards out. When the referee's ready, tremendous strike from a free kick. And that is enough to secure a 1-1 draw. Well, this is one of the big games that most had penciled into their diaries. Tony Parks on trial in goal for Stoke City. Doesn't make the best of starts, and Bob Taylor can capitalise as West Brom take a lead at the Victoria Ground. More than 18,000 fans watch the game, the fifth biggest gate of the country, and they all watch as Steve Foley breaks through and keeps his cool to level things. Lovely chip you see there from Foley. Doesn't score too many, but they're usually good strikes when they do come. Good long ball from Paul Ware, though, sets Mark Stein away on the right-hand side. Twisting and turning, eventually gets his cross in. And there, diving in, is Kevin Russell to slam the ball home from close range. Good work from Steen here, gets to the byline, good cross back. And after the scramble, Russell fires home. Tremendous game for the fans, though, this. Plenty of action and plenty of goals, and West Brom played their full part in it. There he is again, diving in where it hurts, Bob Taylor. Bargain buy from Bristol City. Here Taylor acts as provider, plays the ball out wide, and watch that fella in the middle. You don't need to, because the shot comes in from wide and surprises everybody. But the action's incessant here. Kevin Russell anticipates well, and a lovely touch from Stein. Russell finishes it off. Stoke's third. There you see that touch from Steen. Good anticipation there from Russell. Round the keeper. They all go sliding. He keeps his feet. Now the Rooster acts provider. Floats in the corner. The heads go up, and first to receive it is Ian Cranson, who now receives the adulation of the Boothan end. Good finish by Cranson. Doesn't score many, but that's the winner, 4-3. Well, by now, Stoke's league campaign is gaining momentum. It's into the cup, though, for this visit to the Abbey Stadium. Stoke taking an early lead there through Mark Stein. It's a foul night in Cambridgeshire, but they won't be worried about the weather there. The equaliser coming midway through the game. Russell, though, on the left here, picking it up for Stoke. Of course, Stoke, the second division side, Cambridge, the first division side, but Stoke taking something of a shock, 2-1 lead through Mark Stein again. But Steen's goal, not enough, 2-2. And so to Mansfield, back in the league. Mansfield were to be relegated, of course, and this, a good day for Stoke City. Stein on the end of it once again. That's 1-0. A misty, murky day in Nottinghamshire. But Stoke looking to score more goals. Indeed, they are to score more goals. And here's Paul Ware bursting through from the middle of the park. Similar to Stein, anything you can do, I can do better, he says. Tony Parks, still on trial at Stoke, launching the ball downfield again. Biggins, you'll see there, winning the ball. But eventually it's played out to Kevin Russell. Shows a clean pair of heels and Steen's there ahead of the defenders once more to slot in his second of the game. Well, by now it's a bit of a cakewalk for Stoke, but they haven't done yet. They're looking for more goals. Remember, they could count for something at the end of the season. And here's Wayne Biggins, and that's to prove his final goal for the club. After an excellent spell, he joined them for £250,000 from Manchester City. It proved to be a bit of a bargain. As Bertie Biggins waves bye-bye and heads for Barnsley, let's look now behind the scenes at Stoke City, and a vital part of any football club, that's the treatment room and the physio, Richard Gray here. It's all high-tech these days, of course, a constant battle to keep these highly tuned athletes fit and ready for action. Carl Beeston's been missing at the start of the campaign, Richard Gray doing his utmost to get him back out on the pitch, of course. It's a hard life being a footballer, isn't it? Yes, it really does look like that inside. Beeston doesn't look too impressed, though, does he? Well, they say footballers like a bit of a knees up. With his knee up now, it's Kevin Russell. I just want to know why he's got hair gel on his legs, though. These days, the physios, and here Richard Gray, use high-tech ultrasound equipment to try and speed up the recovery process. And you know, they do say that Kevin Russell and Richard Gray, the physio, are related somehow. Can you spot the difference?
Yeah, Ivan, the most amusing one to me was away at Hartlepool. Me and Kevin Russell, the rooster, sharing rooms. I betted him a tenner to streak up and down the hallway. No clothes on, obviously. And then the bet was fulfilled, because he just opened the door and I said to him, "You ready?" He said, "Yeah, I'm ready now." So he just took his clothes all off and he just legged it down the hallway, and it was absolutely miles to tell. This particular hotel anyway is. And he got to one end, jumped up the wall, turned, sprinted past the door, and then went to the other end, sprinted past, and he just got in the door. As I was just pushing it towards the locket, he just got in the door, and two old ladies walked around the corner, and that was one of the most funniest things I've ever seen, that slaphead running up and down that hallway. It was brilliant.
Well, let's take an early check on the second division league table. As you can see, West Brom, as many people predicted, storming away at the top, but it's very early days. They're well clear of Stoke at this stage, of course, but it's a long, long season, so plenty of time to go. Stoke at this stage midway down in 11th position. But as you see, Stockport County in the frame again. So it's off to Chester City, to the new Diva Stadium, and Beeston's back. Tremendous strike from him. But not enough. Chester hit back and equalise. And so from the league to the cup, and Stoke hoping to make progress at the expense of Cambridge United. Remember that 2-2 draw at the Abbey Stadium. A great start though for the first division side, 18 yards out, and beats trialist Horn quite comfortably there with a superb strike into the booth and end. But Stoke's hopes are raised here from the corner. Stein unmarked, perhaps should have done better, cleared off the line though. Cambridge on the attack again, but Horn sees very quickly that Stein and Shaw are racing down the middle of the field. It's Shaw who gets there first, and without a touch, bang, over it goes. Well taken goal by the Stoke on Trent boy. But sadly, Stoke are on their way out of the cup. This goal enough to dump them out of the Coca-Cola Cup. Well, now we're into October, and Stoke City's unbeaten league run stands at 6 games. Orient, early front runners, come to the Victoria ground. Steno, twisting and turning, got to be a penalty. Indeed it is. You'd put your shirt on him scoring here, wouldn't you? Perhaps you regret the fact that you did now. Steno really didn't have the best of days. Lots of chances, including that penalty miss. Here's another. Does everything right, and then misses the target. Well, Orient have started the season well, and the distinctive figure of Ricky Otto here firing them into a surprise lead. But Stoke never give up. Tremendous strike from Beeston there, off the woodwork. And Steen's alert enough, he's the first to react. And after so many misses, he's relieved to see that one going. But as we're to see throughout the season, Stoke's never say die attitude is to help them out of many a tight situation. And it's the same again here. And maybe the proof of a good striker, Stein misses a lot, but he scores a lot too, doesn't he? And there he is, popping up, profiting from Shaw's work, goal. 2-1. And so it's back to Preston. Remember that early Coca-Cola Cup visit? Well, it's back to the plastic, and Graham Harvey. Nice cross. John Butler, with a rare forward surge, getting on the end of it. But it's an awful long way back, isn't it, for John? Butler again involved. Long, long ball through the middle to Stein here. Again, he looks favourite to score. But just wide of the target. Well, here we see Graham Harvey once again, the left back, signed from West Brom in the close season. Yet another good telling cross, and yet another goal. Well taken by Sanford, scores many an important goal during the season. And the fans like it, don't they? It's a wet, miserable afternoon, but Stoke City supporters, by this stage, as the sun begins to peek through the clouds, have got plenty to smile about. And even this late Preston goal isn't about to dampen their spirits. A slow start perhaps, but by late October, Stoke City came to the Victoria ground for the first of many derby games against Port Vale, looking as though they were beginning to live up to their pre-season championship favourites billing. It was a white-hot atmosphere at the Victoria ground that Saturday afternoon, the terraces here bulging at the seams. Yes, that Potter's Derby number one, one of many, of course, and the whole of the Potter's, it seemed, at the Victoria Ground to see a thrilling game. Ray Walker floats the ball in, misses everybody, but Ian Taylor, a bargain Port Vale buy from non-league Moore Green at the start of the season, diving in there with Ian Cranson. But Sully takes the throw in quickly, and look out for Paul Kerr. He's on as a substitute. He's to play a vital part in the game in just a moment. Taylor lays it back to him, gets just enough on the shot, and Vale take a lead. And don't they just love it? But blink and you'd miss it. Straight back at the other end, Stoke City are back on level terms. Neil Aspin incensed, free kick given. It's to prove a crucial decision as well. Remember, Stoke and Vale, pre-season favourites for promotion, so there's more than just derby pride at stake here. Another substitute to play a vital part. Kevin Russell trots across to take the free kick, and he wants to get on with it too. In it comes, the heads go up, and there's Ian Cranson, despite the efforts of the men on the line, to sensationally put Stoke back on level terms within a minute. And now a moment that will be long talked about in Potter's football circles. Was it or wasn't it? We'll give you a chance to scrutinise the incident for yourself in a moment. Steen thinks he's offside, then he goes on, takes it round the keeper and goes down. Penalty's given. Now the Vale fans and the Vale players particularly can't believe it, but we've done our own close-up examination of the incident. Although it probably throws up more questions than answers. Penalty given, you make your own mind up. Steen's taking it wide. Musselwhite goes in, but does he touch him? Well, Steen doesn't care. Bang, goal, 2-1, and a memorable victory for Stoke City. Well, now it's off to Turf Moor to face Burnley, and a good day for Stoke, and a good day particularly for Graham Shaw, as we'll see in just a moment. An early chance there, though, crashes against the woodwork. Big Stoke following in Lancashire for this one. Another opportunity, sure they're denied. I don't think the defender knew too much about it. But despite those early misses, it was to be Stoke's day, and it was to be Shaw's day, eventually, from close range there. Fairly straightforward stuff here from Stoke. Long ball pumped forward. Eventually it's headed back in. And a great strike from Shaw. It doesn't matter how they go in, but I'm sure he enjoyed that one. 2-0 and a good win for the Potters. Well, now it's off to Craven Cottage. Not too many goals about in London on this night. Fulham, early season playoff candidates. Steen here though, thinks he's got a sniff of the first goal. Not to be. Good save from Stannard. This perhaps Stoke's second best opportunity of the night. They don't come much better than that, do they? But a good save from Stannard denying Steen. 0-0. Well, by now, Stoke season really has taken on a whole new momentum. Steen here, scoring goal number 14 of the season. It's been a tremendous start from him, that one from the spot. But he hasn't finished yet. And a lovely finish there to deny the Bournemouth keeper. 2-0 win.
Bowley is trying to feed Steen, who's still got a chance. And he's sharp here, lovely turn from Steen. And that was a real threat from Mark Steen.
Well, he did everything right there, Ian, except finish it off.
Kingsman, don't have the trouble we've got up here.
Stoke with yet another corner. Knocked around dangerously in there.
I think this is going to be very tight tonight. Yeah.
We speak as neutrals, of course. Gleghorn gets the return from Foley. Here's Shaw. Beeston trying to find a way through. He almost... Oh, Beeston! And, well, that was nearly something for Stoke City. Steen. Russell. And the feeling grows that it'll take one moment of great flair or inspiration maybe to settle this, or one very important mistake by somebody. And here's Russell right through. And it's offside. It's offside. It won't count. He doesn't know it. Flags up. Port Vale had stopped.
But a nice bit of play nonetheless from Stoke, wasn't it? Good little football here that's played in. And there's Russell there. There you see the touch. And he is offside. He took a gamble, did Sully there in stepping out. But I think there he made the right decision.
Yeah, I don't score many goals, so like obviously the three goals I've scored this year, two of them I think have been quite critical really, where the games against West Brom and the Vale where I've scored the two. Probably the best goal that I did score was the one that wasn't so much at stake at the Huddersfield. That was the most enjoyable goal for myself, but obviously we were 2-0 up at the time, so there was no real pressure on us as such.
Any play. Ayres drives it in. Gauk! Shot was blocked. Gauk follows it up. Chances. Ward! Goal for Blackpool! Ashley Ward! On his debut. Blackpool fans going mad. Stoke fans suddenly go quiet, but Blackpool have the lead. Ball is knocked through by Briggs. And Ashley Ward gives Blackpool the lead. And that's not going to do anything to ease the tension on this start ground at the moment. And there's Steve Foley. Ball forward for Shaw is a good one. Russell's in the middle, being joined by Steen. Goes around Horner. Great run. Headed by Russell, goal. That's an excellent goal by Stoke. Wonderful run. An absolutely wonderful run by Graham Shaw. Stoke fans invade the pitch, and that's 1-1. Corner, Shaw, Stein, Mark Stein, 2-1, great finish by Mark Stein. Blackpool's defence left wanting again as Stein went through the middle. And a lovely ball that went through. And Mark Stein's made it 2-1. Russell. Still Russell, great run by Kevin Russell. That's a marvellous goal by Kevin Russell. That's a marvellous goal. That's brilliant. That really was truly brilliant. A minute and a second half gone.
From the correct place. As Kevin Russell's trying to steal a yard or two there. The referee and the linesman are having none of that. Don't he take him from the right place? As Russell will take the free kick, the ball comes across. And the ball's in the net. Stoke City have scored here at Vale Park. From that cross from Kevin Russell, the ball came over. It was headed forward. And Graham Shaw, as you feel, that's got the touch on
that.
As Cross is in possession for Port Vale. And it's Foyle. You've got to fancy him from here. And he's levelled the score. Martin Foyle has scored for Port Vale. It's Port Vale 1, Stoke City 1.
Floats it forward, Nicky Cross is up there, Andy Porter gets it to Nicky Cross, and now Porter shoots and a goal! What a goal for Port Vale to go in 2-1! But to Martin Foyle, and Foyle goes round St Clair, and this is goal number 3 for Port Vale!
And what a great goal for...
So on to the league and Swansea City. The next visitors to the Victoria ground. Good early opportunity for Stein on the chase, but a good save from the Swansea keeper there. Little touch there from Graham Shaw, almost sets up Kevin Russell, but he's denied by the angle of post and bar, and you can hardly believe it. Russell again here with the throw-in, touch from Stein, looking for the cross early. Lovely work from Graham Shaw, takes it ever so well, turns and fires home. And doesn't he just love it? Stoke on their way to victory here, but Swansea have made a decent start to the season, and that was a decent finish, just underneath Ronnie Sinclair's dive. Good header there from Overson sets up the initial opportunity. Long ball pumped forward. Shaw's on the chase. He goes down. Surely there's no argument about that one. Stein, though, makes no mistake. 2-1 secures the win. So let's have a look at the table. You remember last time we saw it, Stoke midway down the table. 9 games further on, the picture looks much more healthy, doesn't it? A run of 8 wins in 9 games has taken them to the top. Now Huddersfield last season were among the front runners. They're struggling at the start of this, and here we can see exactly why. A comprehensive win for Stoke. Russell setting up Shaw, another goal for him. Or so we thought, that early effort disallowed. Steve Foley on a mazy run through the Huddersfield defence. Deserved much better there, didn't he? Good effort from the midfielder. And as the ball comes in, over it goes. Into the second half then, and Stoke still looking to break the deadlock. The goalkeeper's come from absolutely nowhere, and he's left in no man's land. Stoke celebrate 1-0. Now looking to press home their advantage. The Rooster takes the corner, it's flicked on. And Paul Ware with another rare goal, but welcome nonetheless. Two-nil, it's looking comfortable, but Stoke haven't finished yet. Ian Cranson, an absolutely sensational finish from the defender. Well, David Regis, he's been with the club some time, but that's his first goal, and very welcome to away to Hartlepool. Well, Hartlepool, of course, were to go an awful long time without scoring after beating Palace in the Cup, but here's one that did score before Christmas. But Stoke, though, are to take the points. Good header, and that's enough to win it for them. Nigel Gleghorn with his first for the club. And so to Rotherham, again surprise early front runners in the race for Division 1. They're at the Victoria ground. Festivities in the air. The turkey goes down well, but sadly David Regis misses the target. Stoke, of course, by now have opened up a great gap at the top of the league. Here, Russell denied by the woodwork again. Good ball from Sanford there. He finds Regis, who battles away. Foley takes over. And there's Russell. Does superbly well to get the ball back. And there's Carl Beeston. Back on the scene with a vengeance. Good goal. I suppose I could say it was a Christmas cracker, but I won't. Into the second half then, Stoke looking to press home their advantage. Regis does very well for a big man there, doesn't he? Keeps the ball in play, fires it low. Great save from the keeper though. Just a shame it's from his own player, wasn't it? But eventually Stoke wrap it up. Again Regis the supplier. Coming back from the byline, Foley on the end of it. Good strike on the volley, 20 yards out, 2-0. Well, as we race towards the midpoint of the season, Stoke City had raced towards the top of the table. In fact, they'd hit the top late in November. So we reached the turn of the year. We just enjoyed the festivities at Christmas against Rotherham, a 2-0 home win and the second biggest home gate of the season. Now, attention turned to the Autoglass Trophy. Remember Wembley in May last year? Stoke City set out on the defence against Crewe Alexandra. Yes, the Alex from across the border in South Cheshire. Didn't really go their way, though, in the opening stages, as Stoke took an early lead. Nigel Gleghorn, though, on that occasion, just over the bar. Gleghorn doing well again, this time the provider. Stein, though, denied by the goalkeeper. Here we see Kevin Russell twisting and turning down the line. Inside to Mark Stein. Now, was that a cross or was that a shot? I guess we'll never know. But the goalkeeper did well to touch it over anyway. Lots of incident in this cup game. Lots of interest too, of course. And this time Russell, with a good effort, looked to be going wide, but somehow it managed to creep its way over the line. Well, Stoke scored twice in a minute in this game. As we'll see later, Crewe were to do likewise. But from this throw-in, Russell sees it quickly. Stein turns quickly as well. And there's big David Regis at the near post, heading into an empty net. Jim Harvey was to be instrumental in the second half fight back by Crewe. Big Stuart Evans goes through on the keeper. The keeper somehow loses it and, well, again, he's nowhere in sight as the ball drifts over the line. The Alex back in it. It was a spirited second half display by Dario Gradi's side. And here's their second goal in 60 seconds. Fired home, 2-2. So, Stoke safely through the qualifying stages of the Autoglass. Now it's back to the league and down to the Goldstone ground. And Mark Stein again on target with an important goal. Stoke today hoping to set a new club record of undefeated games in the league. But Brighton equalise and then take a 2-1 lead. But Stoke's never-say-die attitude comes to the fore again. And here, in the dying seconds, Steve Foley breaks through, scores 2-2. The record goes to 19 now.
Well, obviously, the derby game against Port Vale was my debut, and it sort of sticks out. But I think my favourite game was at Hartlepool. Gone back up to my neck of the woods and scored the winner with, the last header of the game, really. And it was my first goal for Stoke City, and, yeah, I remember that one. It's a good game for me to remember.
Well, if you ask a Mansfield Town supporter what his highlights of the season were, I'm pretty sure he won't mention the two games against Stoke. Stoke, in fact, scored 8 without reply against Mansfield. Here, Steno doing his best. But it's Kevin Russell who comes in to tidy things up. By now, Stoke really on a roll, of course. Russell again doing well inside his own half. The chase is on and Regis picks it up. And Rooster has continued his run and he's still there, chipping away, strikes it. Now, who did that come off? It looked like the defender, though Stein might just claim it. Again, David Ridge is figuring strongly in this one. So strongly, in fact, that he whacks the ball home. 3-0 to Stoke. They're in rampant form at this stage of the season. And here's the nail in the Mansfield coffin. Goal from Vince Overson, the skipper, getting on the score sheet. Well, from the league, let's turn our attention again to the Autoglass Trophy. Remember, they've qualified against Wrexham and Crewe in that round-robin stage, and now it's the automatic knockout. Foley had a great night. Stigger, as is known, scoring the first of three memorable goals. In comes the ball from the corner. Good punch from the keeper. Rooster's there again, though, to clip the ball across. And the keeper does well again. Bit of a battle between those two. Eventually, though, he's not quite good enough, and Nigel Gleghorn loops their header home. This had, on paper at least, looked a tricky fixture for Stoke. Barnet leading the way in the third division, but Stoke did emphasise their superiority. And despite this little hiccup, making it 2-1, they were to go on and win the game comfortably. Stein, the provider on this occasion, from the left. He gets two bites at the cherry, and it falls to Foley. And as we said, it was a good night for the young Merseysider. I'm sure he'll be very happy with the description of young as well. I'll get my little commission after the programme. Stein, though, plays the ball forward again to Steve Foley, and another good finish from the Merseysider makes it 4-1. And so to the Hawthorns and the battle of the two big championship contenders, or so we thought at that stage. Nigel Gleghorn receives the adulation of his colleagues as he puts Stoke ahead in the game. Much to the delight of the fans as well. An army of them has travelled to the Hawthorns. It really is the battle of the big guns, and Bob Taylor proves why he's a highly rated striker. Note David Speedy within them, because Speedy was on loan to West Brom at the time. 1-1, tremendous atmosphere, a lot of tension. Three important points hanging on this one, of course. Great save from the Stoke City keeper there, getting down well. Ron Sinclair, a bit of an unsung hero. What a shame eventually he had to leave the pitch late on in the season for that crucial knee operation. But he certainly plays his part in this victory. But here it's the attackers that do their bit. Overson on to Russell. Russell splits the defence open, and there's that man Mark Stein again. Shoots, but this time denied by the West Brom keeper. Stoke have the wind at their backs now. They're looking to press home the advantage too. It falls to Russell, drives it back in. Somehow, it finds its way in the back of the net. Mark Stein claims the goal, 2-1.
Pitch is bound to cut up here after 48 hours of incessant rain. As Sanford swings the first free kick menacingly into the penalty area. Regis up well. Exeter survived the first assault on their goal, but have they, as Stein breaks clear? The linesman's flag was raised almost the moment Stein slammed the ball into the net for what would have been one of the quickest goals of the season. Side, but Whiston, the captain, gets to the ball first. And that's a dangerous ball across the face of the goal, and it's in, yes! Foley gets it back from Gleghorn and drives it in hard, low and dangerous, and that's a great finish post when Foley whipped in a perfect example of that. Look at that, always intent on being their first, Regis, and even Miller and his heroics for Exeter tonight couldn't do anything about that. The ball forward by Cranston is an excellent one, and Regis was hauled back surely. Now the referee's got an interesting decision to make here. Scott Daniels undoubtedly hauled back the Stoke City man, and
know what action the referee will decide to take here. If he decides that was a foul, and I can't see how he could think otherwise, then the question is, was the Stoke City player clear on goal? It's a red card. It had to be, frankly. I think the referee has interpreted that one absolutely right. And we can see again how beautifully struck that shot was through the wall, onto the inside of the post.
Well, things going well on the pitch. Let's once again go behind the scenes of the Victoria Ground, this time to yet another very important area of the ground, and one you won't see too much of or hear about either. This is the laundry room. And there's Wynne, dear old Wynne. She takes some stick from the lads, but I think they love her dearly. Who says that Stoke City are a dirty team? Well, nobody would dare to say that, but they certainly are turned out well. It's the tea room, the washroom, the boot room, you name it. It's a focal point for the players. And certainly plenty of unsung heroes in any football club. Wynne, without doubt, is one of them. Does your kitchen look like that?
The last one. The final whistle of the last game. Had to be. We realised that we'd got promotion and we were the champions. Simple as that. Oh, you want more? That's fine. Well, no, I think that's the main one. Promotion's there. I mean, shut up, Lee. We were going for promotion. We got it. They're saying we're champions. There's another medal.
At the end of the day.
Loads of money. And that's about it, really. I just hope I'm one of the half a dozen players that are staying here next season, going to the gaffer. Edit. No, it's got to be the last game, final whistle, when we realised that we were champions. And all credit to John Butler, because he's an unsung hero.
And so to Wigan. Stoke City fans will remember that Wigan was the venue for Alan Ball's last game in charge. But this is a mighty different Stoke City side, and that is one of the goals of the season, isn't it? Opportunism from Carl Beeston. He tells me it was 80 yards out, but I think it was just slightly less. But it wasn't a day for unbounded celebrations. Stoke weren't to take all 3 points, and that's why Wigan with their equaliser, 1-1. Now Hull City the visitors to the Victoria Ground. Stein crosses all the way along the edge of the six-yard box, and eventually Paul Ware from just across the border in South Cheshire, so we can count him as a potter, scores from no more than 3 or 4 yards. He'd like those every day, really, wouldn't he? Graham Shaw gets 2 bites of the cherry here, crosses. Nice little ball back from Stein, and in it goes, sneaks in at the near post. Steve Foley with another important goal. So 2-0, Stoke go looking for the third, and they don't come much sweeter than that, do they? Mark Stein with yet another. Well, with the league double completed over West Brom, it was back to the Victoria Ground now for Stoke City's continued defence in the Autoglass Trophy. And as we'll see, they were to complete the hat-trick against West Brom. Mark Stein with 2 great goals, on this occasion though, just narrowly missing the target. Amazing scramble there, as we see, not the best start for Stoke, as Bob Taylor, in off the post, scrambles home the first goal of the night. Now the former West Brom fullback Graham Harvey lifts the ball into the box here. Great turn from Stein, in off the post, it doesn't matter. They all count. Really is a fabulous season for Stein, and he completes his double a short time later. Great work from Regis on the left-hand side. These two Stoke goals coming in the last 15 minutes, and what a volley that was. First time, didn't think about it. Stein wraps it up for Stoke, on they march towards Wembley. Back to the league, Bradford the visitors, and the ball's bouncing about. The referee goes down, gets it where it really does hurt. Still, back to the action, Russell floating the ball in deep. Misses everybody. Remember back in September, that defeat at Valley Parade? That started Stoke off on the run that they're still on at this stage. Vince Overson trying to extend it there, but forces a good save from the keeper. Yes, this to be the day when Stoke extended that amazing league unbeaten run to 25 games. Regis heads on. It's into the path of Stein, but his shot rattles the crossbar. David Kevin reacts quickest, though. A 1-0 win. Kevin scores the only goal of the game. And so it's off to East London, to Brisbane Road. Stoke looking to make it 26 in a row, but it's not to be. Ricky Otto, once again, the scorer. Well, it was a quite marvellous run, the talk of the league, but it had to come to an end, and it came to an end there in disappointing fashion, away to Leighton Orient. But now it was back to the Potteries, and very much the talk of the town, an Autoglass Trophy game against the old rivals Port Vale. But you know, the Stoke City manager Lou Macari has got his own thoughts on derby games.
Pain in the backside, Ivan. The pressure leading up to them, and the game itself, and the hullabaloo after it. And if I'm going to be honest, I'd prefer not to have them. As the manager of this club, probably one of the reasons why, you know, we promoted. I'm not really looking forward to Port Vale getting promoted. Here we go again the following season, having two more events like that. They're good if you win. They're not great fun leading up to it, but they're good if you win. Not so good if, obviously, if you get beat. And I'm sure both myself and Rudgie would prefer to do without them. I'm quite sure he'd settle for playing them next season again, but I'd prefer not to.
Looking back at the league campaign then, Christmas time or thereabouts, you hit the top spot, and it's a position you held right to the end of the season. Is it easy being front runners like that?
Well, all credit to the team, because the Doom Merchants were out again, I think, at the time, saying they won't stay there. Come the end of the season, when last year we started to hiccup a little bit, and we were only a couple of points clear last season. Again, the Doom Merchants come out, and we lost a game here to I think it was Blackpool. And everyone was saying, well, that's it, they're going to slide. I never ever felt that we were going to get ourselves in that position, that the team would dip. I was well aware that come the end of the season, when the winning post was in sight and you were a couple of points from winning the championship, I did feel then we maybe had a team of certain people in the side that might panic a little bit. But I never felt they would lose their position at the top like we did late on last year. And of course, that's the way the season went for us. We stayed at the top. We did start to panic a little bit towards the end. But it's expecting too much for a team to stay at the top and roll on week in, week out, and win and perform okay and not show any nerves, because it, you know, human beings, we all become nervous. And on the night we got promoted against Plymouth, and I was sitting in the dugout and I had a terrible fear. And my biggest fear, funny enough, came when we were winning 1-0 and there was a couple of minutes to go, and I looked at my watch and it was 88 minutes had gone. And I'd been at Bournemouth a couple of nights earlier, and Bolton had scored 2 minutes from the end. And I don't know why, but this just feeling of 2 minutes from the end came into my mind, that we were going to get done again. And we had an almighty goalmouth scramble up at the top end here. And we threw bodies in front of the ball, and we managed to keep every shot out, and shots were getting blocked here, there and everywhere. And I just felt, had one gone in then and we'd ended up 1-1. I didn't like the look of the fixtures that lay ahead.
Hang it off. Once again it was Glover who got it away. Here's Taylor chasing with Overson. A young man in his first season in big time football against one of the most experienced defenders around.
Yeah, it was good movement by Taylor when that ball was played back.
Port Vale have a free kick here.
Sully is the man who's come across to take it. Vanderlaan's gone forward, so too has Glover. Taylor's useful in the air. Vanderlaan has scored! Robbie Vanderlaan, the Dutchman, puts Port Vale into the lead here in the second half.
So, no return to Wembley for Stoke this time, their Potterers neighbours denying them that. Back to the league and back to the Victoria ground to face Chester. Mark Stein opening his account in the game. It was to be a good day for Stoke. Chester struggling for points, eventually to be relegated. A day they'll want to forget. Stein helping the ball on here. Foley on the left-hand side of the box. Looking a bit of trickery. And there's Graham Shaw. Simple as that. 2-0. Again, Shaw prominent in the attack, holds the ball up well. Beeston just about sneaks it away to Gleghorn, and there's Stein again, getting in first, makes it 3-0. Well, last year Chester spoiled Stoke City's hopes of promotion with a win at the Victoria ground right at the death. And the crossbar spoiling Graham Shaw's hopes of celebrations there. Steve Foley, though, with a big smile on his face, capitalises on the ball bouncing back. Stockport, the next visitors, a midweek game of the Victoria ground. At this stage, Stockport not out of it as far as promotion are concerned, so this a big game. Shaw, super cross, super header, again the woodwork denies them. The shots coming in from all angles, eventually the ball drifts past the post. Now here's Rooster, looking to take a quick free kick, does so towards the near post. They get it away temporarily, again it's a case of pinball in the box, and they hoist it away towards the halfway line. Frayed nerves at the Victoria ground, can they break the deadlock is the big question. Again the cross comes in, again it's off the line, but this time Stein is successful, in it goes. Stockport looking to hit back straight away. The ball goes into the box and there's big Kevin Francis, the tallest player in the league. Scores plenty of goals too, and my, they can celebrate. So it's a tense end to the game. Stoke looking for points to further cement their position at the top of the table. Russell to float the corner in again. The heads go up, bounce, and in it goes. Definitely crosses the line. The Stoke players, particularly Nigel Gleghorn, with reasons to be cheerful.
Yes. No, I'm not bothered. All the lads, you know, stick together out there, and we all know we're doing our bit. So, probably what sticks out in my mind is the Vale games, especially 2-0 at the Vale in the league, especially my run down the wing, Stanley Matthews tight run, which the fans were very pleased with, so I was pleased with that.
And so the league campaign soldiers on, Mark Stein goes down, penalty given. The Bournemouth players don't like it, but nonetheless, goal is given, and Stein brushes himself down and smashes the ball home from the spot. It wasn't to be all Stoke's way. Bournemouth hung on, the Cherries looking for a point, and they get 1-2. Through that goal. And at this point, it's hello to Liverpool's Bruce Grobbelaar, because he's on loan to Stoke City. A welcome addition to the squad. Sadly for Ronnie Sinclair, it's at his expense. After that Bournemouth game, knee ligament damage is diagnosed, and he will miss the rest of the season and maybe some of next. But Grobbelaar arrives and keeps a clean sheet on this, his first game at the Victoria ground. Stoke eventually win the game. Stein going down again. Looks like another penalty.
and the referee has no doubts. The Fulham players weren't happy about the decision, but what mattered was the referee gave it. Stein kept his head, and after quite a long delay, he stepped up. Game at Swansea. Stoke City looking to win away from home. Difficult place to go. Swansea having a decent season themselves. Leghorn there brings them back level. And here, looking for the winner, Beeston tries to square, does ever so well, pulls it back, and there's Steve Foley, 2-1 win. Now, the season is steaming along for Stoke until this day. The Tangerines on the way from the seaside, Blackpool the visitors. And sadly for Stoke, this was to be one of their less memorable days. Blackpool struggling for points at the foot of the table, though you wouldn't have guessed it on this day. Hitting the crossbar, great effort from him. But by the way, Stoke just couldn't break Blackpool down, and you began to get the feeling it might be one of those days. But Stoke turned the screw, and that looked like it was destined for the goal, didn't it? Bit of a deflection though, just enough to touch it onto the post and behind, much to the relief of the Blackpool keeper. Well, 89 agonising minutes pass, still Stoke don't break down the Blackpool defence. And the longer it goes on, you feel they might just break away and sneak a winner. And indeed they do. This one on the break, an opportunist strike from Trevor Sinclair, a shock victory for Blackpool. And so to yet another significant night, another derby game against the old rivals Port Vale, and this perhaps the night when Stoke City fans began to believe that the championship and certainly promotion could be and would be theirs. Watch out here, terrific run coming up from John Buckler, that's two, three, could be Stanley Matthews on the wing there, couldn't it? Great pullback and a tremendous finish from Mark Stein. They don't come much better than that. Roger Milford doesn't want any hanky-panky or hanging about by the corner flag. He wants them to get on with it. You try telling that to the Stoke fans. So 1-0, and the game still poised on a knife edge as David Kevin trots over to take this corner on the right. And this the moment that clinches the 3 points and possibly promotion. Nigel Gleghorn rising first despite the efforts on the line, in it goes, and that wraps up a 2-0 win and a memorable one too. Now, if you're looking for heroes, we've got one here at the Victoria Ground. He's 5'5" and a package of dynamite. His name? Mark Stein. In just 2 short years at the Victoria Ground, Steino, as he's known by his adoring fans at the booth and end and all around the Victoria Ground, has become also known as the Golden One. Before he came to the Victoria Ground, Stein really wasn't recognised as a prolific goal scorer. But goals he's scored in abundance over the last 2 seasons. But he isn't just about goals, he's a real handful for any defender. With his close control, his bustling style, and his real eye for shooting, Stein has become one of the most feared strikers in the game. But this is what he enjoys doing most. Mark Stein, a modern-day hero.
Last season was good for you. Did you think at the start that you could better it?
Obviously, we had high hopes of being up there after last season when we just missed out. We still felt we were like the best team in the league, and we just had to prove to a lot of people what we believed in.
You scored an awful lot of goals personally last year. Did you set yourself another target this time round?
I just went out there thinking if I could better my score of 22 last year, sort of like it'd be okay, and sort of I've surpassed it and got 32, which is unbelievable for me really.
So the last 2 years have been your best, haven't they?
Yeah, sort of. All the lads, sort of, when I first come here, so I didn't get off to the best of starts, but when I started scoring regular with Wayne Biggins and that, sort of it's all gone from there, really.
Now, most people look at your partnership with Wayne Biggins, Bertie as he used to be called, and looked at that as one with the other, that you had to be together. He went, of course. How did that affect you?
Obviously, it was a big blow for all the lads, because we all sort of got on well together, and sort of he was a popular person in the team, in the dressing room, and with the supporters and that. And he made a decision, I think, for his family more really than sort of just going to Barnsley, I think, because I think he knew Stoke were going places and that, but I think it just hinged on financial things really.
But did you miss him personally as a striking partner?
Yeah, obviously. We hit it off straight away when I first come here. That was one of the reasons why I come. And, we've gone on from, Bertie, but, obviously, I think we did miss him, really.
Because there was a lot of talk that without him you wouldn't score goals. You've obviously proved that was wrong, because you've gone on to score even more.
I wouldn't say that, because, me and Bertie did score a lot of goals, but sort of that's taken away from all the other players and that. And I think, it'd be a disservice to the other lads. And, I don't think one person makes a team or two people, and sort of we've just shown our character throughout the season that, what a good team we were.
Why do you think you've started scoring goals at Stoke when down the years in your career at other top clubs you haven't been a prolific scorer, let's say?
I think the emphasis has never really been myself, thinking-wise, that I was a goal scorer. I was more of a sort of setter-upper and that. And the manager's changed my views on that, and he said, you want to change your outlook on stay in the box more, different things, instead of doing all your hard work outside the box, and it's paid off. So, I'm glad he's really done it, and I haven't looked back since.
I mean, it's difficult for you, having scored 32, to pick out individual games and individual moments, but are there any moments or any games that stand out for you?
I think the Port Vale game. Both Port Vale games, close fought or whatever, and I've been fortunate to score in the first one, my first ever derby, dubious penalty, but that's the way things go. And when we beat them 2-0 at Vale Park, there's a lot riding on it, and we lost the previous game, and we had a lot to prove, I think, and we went out there and we showed people what we were really made of.
And can you pick out one of your goals that perhaps stands out to you as well as a striker? You feel that it was a great effort yourself?
I think the Rotherham goal, my second goal, I don't think I hit anything sweeter than that. But any goal, because the way we got the way we played all season, and basically the supporters have been tremendous all through the season. So to score goals in front of the fans is a real bonus for anybody, I think.
So to Edgeley Park and last year's constant rival, Stockport County. Remember those three games in a week that culminated in that Wembley victory? Well, this time league points crucial again, and Stoke City earning a 1-1 draw away to their Cheshire neighbours. On their travels again just 4 days later, and the ball getting stuck firmly in the stanchion there, a 1-0 defeat at Huddersfield. Well, Stoke emerged from those difficult away games relatively unscathed and still leading the way at the top of the table. Now they face what looked on paper at least to be a relatively easy run-in. Five out of the next seven games were at home. Well, before the action, let's take a closer look at that league table. As you can see, Stoke still the clear leaders. Bolton, though, coming up on the rails at the foot of the picture there. Well, to the first of those closing seven games, and that was at home against Reading, and it proved to be another victory for Stoke City on the way to the title. For once, Mark Stein not on the score sheet, but acts as provider here. For Graham Shaw, one touch over the bar though. Now, appeals for handball there though. The linesman doesn't want to know, and Shaw carries on towards the box. The ball comes in, header, great opportunity, over it goes. Poor old Steve Foley wants a hole to swallow him up, but it won't. He'll have to dust himself down and get on with it. So, Stoke still looking to break the deadlock. Bright, sunny afternoon in April. The keeper comes out, tries to clear. Steve Francis, the keeper, but it's embarrassment for him as Graham Shaw's in the right place at the right time. And they don't come much easier than that, do they? I wonder if he said thank you to the keeper as well. One nil though, never a safe lead. And here the Potter's looking to make it two. Beeston takes it well, but then he's felled on the edge of the box. No doubt about it, free kick, and Beeston looking in some pain here. Quite a bit of concern around him, but eventually they're ready to take the free kick, and as you can see, Beeston hobbling away, and while they're looking at him, Gleghorn steps up and strikes it beautifully into the back of the net. 2-0 wraps up the game. And now it's to Rotherham. Early front runners, but they've faded somewhat now, and Mark Stein scores yet another goal for him, the first for Stoke on this occasion at Millmore. Stein very much in the action here, and what a shot that was. As you've already heard, Steno thought that was the best strike of the season for him. But it wasn't always roses for Stoke on their way to the title, of course. This was one of the darker days. Hartlepool, haunted by relegation, came to the Victoria ground towards the end of the season, looking for points to help save themselves. It was to prove a frustrating day for Stoke. Hartlepool put up an 11-man defence. Fox didn't quite gather that one cleanly, and Lenny John Rose was there to score what proved to be the only goal of the game. An absolute jubilance for the Hartlepool players and their fans who'd made the long journey. Endless scrambles. Martin Hodge, the veteran Hartlepool goalkeeper, had a storming game and somehow managed to keep his goal intact. Stoke launched yet another assault on the Hartlepool goal. Steen, a succession of chances went his way. That one, though, went begging. Now, that looked a clear penalty, and the referee had no doubts. Here at last, then, a chance for Stoke City to salvage something from a frustrating afternoon. Here's your man, steps up, goal, surely, not to be, and misses the rebound too. And that summed up the day for Stoke. Well, 1 week later, and Stoke determined to make amends for that defeat against Hartlepool, another team haunted by relegation come to the Victoria ground, Preston North End this time, the former Port Vale winger Stephen Harper here, crossing early. Good opportunity, but great save from Fox. Peter Fox coming to the team late in the season, as he did last year, and he was to prove important too. Here Mark Stein races away from the offside trap, looks up, and another great shot into the corner. That's the goal that wins the game. This was a much brighter performance from Stoke, and perhaps the one that really secured promotion. This one, though, just scraping off the top of the woodwork.
Obviously, settling into the team was important, which wasn't a problem, obviously, with them winning. But helping the lads win that vital game that gave us the 3 points to clinch the championship, because it was getting a little bit nerve-wracking. We had a nice gap, but I mean, we could see Port Vale and Bolton were doing so well. So obviously for me was the Plymouth game, and having to make a couple of saves as well, which were important, made it doubly satisfying for me.
And so to the night on April the 28th that most Stoke City fans will remember for the rest of their lives, the night that the championship and promotion from the second division was achieved. An expectant atmosphere, a packed ground, ready to salute the second division champions. But first, a tight, tense affair, a game against Plymouth Argyle. They put up a great display, did Plymouth, but here, tremendous double save from Fox, the one you just heard him talking about. And that really would have been a setback, wouldn't it, if Plymouth had taken the lead so early. What Stoke really needed, though, was a goal themselves to settle their nerves on this big, big occasion. And a goal they got early on. Here, Graham Shaw breaking forward. And after a bit of a scramble, Nigel Gleghorn scores the goal that takes Stoke into the first division. Great scenes of celebration at the Victoria Ground, but that goal came so early that there were another 80-odd minutes. It was a nerve-jangling experience for everyone. Bit of a mix-up from Peter Shilton and his defenders, but the danger cleared on that occasion. Late on, David Regis comes into the action, but as you can see, great tension on the bench. The supporters ringed around the cinder track at the Victoria Ground, the seconds ticking by. All eyes on the referee. The Potters just seconds away from the championship. Plymouth, though, won't give up. Fox, though, gathers it safely. And there it goes. The championship is theirs. And now it's a mad dash for the tunnel. The players lost in a mass of supporters. Now it's back to the warmth of the dressing room, handshakes all round. And this is where the celebrations really start. Chick Bates, the Stoke City assistant manager, doesn't take too many of the headlines, but certainly great affection among him and the players. And there's genuine relief among those Stoke City players, isn't there? They've led the way so long, but now the moment they can breathe a huge sigh of relief the night they clinched promotion. There's big David Regis, Vince Overson, the skipper who lifted that Autoglass trophy last summer, and now, in the next couple of weeks, will lift the second division championship trophy as well. Peter Fox, whose great double save early on in the game kept Stoke in the game, really. Ian Cranston, John Butler, Steve Foley. I think one of the supporters has managed to sneak his way in too. There's Nello, the kit man, Neil Baldwin, dragging his laundry basket with him. Ashley Grimes, one of the backroom staff, and the man in the overcoat there, director Bob Kenyon. Hugs and kisses all round. I hope the wives aren't watching this. There's Peter Henderson, reserve team coach. Ian Cranston, Lee Sanford. And there's the fans. They've supported Stoke through thick and thin down the years. There hasn't been too much to cheer and smile about in the last few years, of course, but now it really is a sense of relief. An uncorking of the champagne bottles, and Lou Macari shaking the hands of his players. Not a man who displays too much emotion, is Lou. but this means an awful lot to him. Now it's all smiles for the camera, I think. And some traditional football fare for you. I'm told it's the only song they know the words to. But these Stoke City players, it's been a long, hard season. They've every reason to celebrate. These scenes proving maybe that football is worth and about a lot more than just money. It means an awful lot to each individual player and, of course, the management team there in conference, even at this stage. A mass of supporters gathering outside the main doors at the Victoria Ground, clamouring for a glimpse of their heroes. And finally they emerge, and the fans do get their chance to salute them. You recall at that final whistle, the fans swarmed onto the pitch en masse. And all of the players, the directors, the backroom staff, and the supporters, all as one. This really is an occasion to savour. Yes, it's been a long time coming, hasn't it? But Stoke City hope that this is lift-off for them, the start of many a good year. It's been a long, hard season, so many memories and so many incidents. And the players there saluting the fans as well, because they do say these fans give Stoke City a gold start at home, and it's their night as much as the players. Thousands upon thousands of Stoke City supporters massed on this Victoria Ground pitch. And I think just for once, the club and officials don't really mind. There's Paul Ware, just one of a very strong squad that's guided Stoke to the title. And one imagines that the final two games of the season are just going to be one long party. This season and these players are going to go down in Stoke City folklore, of course. 30 years since they last won the Second Division Championship. Back down those stairs, weary but relieved. A lot of joy in those faces. And everywhere you look, there are supporters. Yes, the champagne uncorked. Lou Macari may not drink, but I'm sure these two fellows won't mind a little sip. And he certainly won't. Steve Foley enjoying the celebrations as much as anyone. And so to some joyous scenes at Burnden Park. I don't think the party's stopped since the Plymouth game. But fancy dress, silly hats, loads of balloons, and lots of excitement at colour as Stoke City supporters come here with one thing in mind, a party. For so long, most have seen this as a possible promotion decider, but now the pressure's off, and the Stoke supporters, who really do have the admiration of all of the players and staff at the Victoria Ground, they show exactly what this promotion and championship means to them. There's lots of good humour, lots of noise, and it really is a carnival atmosphere. All of this is hard for Bolton's fans to bear, of course, because this is a crucial game for them. They're neck and neck with Port Vale in the promotion race for the second automatic spot, of course. The Vale on the same night away to Exeter, all ears to the radios, but Bolton need to do the job themselves. Former Stoke man Tony Kelly setting up replacement striker Julian Darby for what proved to be a crucial only goal of the game. Darby in for the injured Andy Walker. And it does seem to me that the Stoke supporters aren't too unhappy with it. It may have dawned on them, of course, that that goal could help Bolton in place of their Potterer's rivals Vale. That was to be the case, of course, despite this late effort from David Regis, almost snatching a goal just wide. That Derby goal, the only one, 1-0 to them. They take over in second spot. So really, you can put your feet up for the summer and enjoy what you've achieved. But of course, as soon as that final whistle went against Plymouth and you were champions, just like the year before, you're already concentrating on what's to come, and there is a very big task now for this season to come and this team in the new First Division.
Well, I think it's there for everyone to see, Ivan, that the division you're going into, even teams that have spent a lot of money, and I'm talking about millions, have proved unsuccessful. If you don't spend some money, you don't improve your team, you're going to be in trouble. Our job is to make sure that all the good work that's gone on and the promotion that we've achieved doesn't all go down the pan in one season. We're not going to kid ourselves that we're good enough to get into that division and sweep everyone aside, because we're not. That's my job. That's my job to come to that decision and to come to that conclusion for no other reason except that's what I honestly believe. I go to games most nights of the week. I go and see the opposition in that league. I see the opposition in our league. The difference is enormous. And as I say, teams like Derby County, it was life or death for them to get out of that division. Spent £12 million, brought in players everyone thought would rip the league to pieces in that season. Didn't achieve it, simply because those players were probably no better than what other teams had, and of course Derby didn't manage to do it. We're going to have to improve the team, and that's no reflection on any player we've got.
It isn't a double-edged sword, though, is it? I mean, you're still very happy to be going into that league, at least, but you've just got to make sure you get it right.
Oh, yeah. In fairness, the teams that got promoted the previous season at our expense, they went into the league and delighted they were in there. They are, apart from Peterborough, and they just won one or two games that got them out of trouble. But, you know, your Birmingham Cities and your Brentford, who went in, I mean, they struggled like anything right throughout the season. We don't really want to be in that position. I'm not saying it can't happen to us, because everyone's in there like the division we've come from, fighting to get as high up as possible. Some will try to do that by splashing out and buying this player and that player. We want to be in there in the running to go and buy a player or two, and to show everyone here that we're not just accepting last season as a one-off. We want to try and achieve better than that.
Really, it's an exclusive for the people that have bought this Stoke City video. I think we can reveal the big news. We know that you're a frequent visitor north of the border. You know the area well. I think you've been and bought a shock signing.
Well, he's a bit of an unknown quantity. I don't even really want to reveal his name. We'll let him do his own talking on the pitch. I think that's the best thing with any new player you bring to the club. Let's see what they do on the pitch, and he'll be given an opportunity. Pre-season matches, we've got to get some weight off him. He's not in the best of condition, but you know, I've put my head on the chopping block and taken that opportunity and brought him here. Let's just see what lies ahead, Ivan. Let's just take it from game to game.
He's all professional. Yes, it smiles all the way, right through until the last day of the season. This, the final game against Burnley, and the presentations begin. The first to Mark Stein, the BBC Radio Stoke Player of the Year. And who's that debonair-looking chap on the right? Stein, a quite marvellous season, of course. 33 goals to his credit after the Burnley game. He scored his final goal in that final game. Lee Sanford, though, got one of the awards too. I think he got the Smile of the Season award, didn't he? But Stein, the popular choice. Well, not quite the golden boot, perhaps the sort of olive brown boot. Well, if you're ever short before a game, Mark, you know where to go. That's a smart-looking shield, yet another award for Stoke City supporters, obviously, clearly, voting Mark Stein their man of the hour. And this young man, meeting his hero. Yet another shield for the Stein mantelpiece. And Peter Coates, the club chairman, gets in on the act with this check. And that's what all the fuss is about. That's the Second Division Championship trophy. It'll be presented in just a few seconds to this bunch of people. Lou Macari and Vince Overson lead them out. There's Ron Sinclair, who's been crippled by injury towards the end of the season. Peter Fox about to play his last game after 15 years at the club as well. Football League officials. It's a highbrow gathering at the Victoria Ground on a day to remember. There's Carl Beeston. Injury ruled him out at the end of the season again. Lou Macari receives a bottle of champagne, but as you know, and as he said there, he doesn't drink. I'm told he's got about 214 bottles hidden away somewhere. And there it is. It's only around 10 inches high. It's made of solid silver. And unlike the World Cup presentation, this means that Stoke City are the Division 2 champions. And they've every reason to be happy about it. Tremendous achievement, and this is the pinnacle of Vince Overson's career. A very proud moment. Smile for the camera, boys. And I'm not sure that they can really hit that top note, can they? I don't think they'll be going in for the Eurovision Song Contest award this year, that's for sure. So that's the squad. They'll go down in Stoke City history. And they're all hoping this is the start of many a good long year. Stoke City, simply the best. And even their opposition, Burnley, prepared to salute them. But there is the little matter of the final game of the season to be taken care of, and Burnley certainly here in a mood to spoil the party. Adrian Randall bursting through, and that's one of the better strikes we've seen at the Victoria Ground this season. And Mark Stein scored 32 great goals during the campaign, and I don't think he wants to let this game go without adding another. He had his chances, and took this one. 33, rounding off a memorable year for him. and what a dancer. The final whistle blows then, the campaign is over, and now it really is a chance to relax and amble around the turf at the Victoria Ground. A lap of honour, the fans staying behind the advertising hoardings. And these are moments that all of the players will remember for some time. Peter Fox there in the centre of the picture, 15 years at Stoke City, his farewell appearance. Nigel Blakehorn, whose goal secured that promotion against Plymouth. Paul Ware there, a valuable member of the squad. John Butler, who started the final game but had to come off because he'd got the flu. Carl Beeston, who didn't play too many games towards the end of the campaign either. Nigel Blakehorn lying down on the job. Nice line of headgear from Foxy at the back there. All the players, all the supporters joined as one. A marvellous occasion, a marvellous season. Six games played, 27 wins, 12 draws and just 7 defeats. 93 points, with 73 goals scored and just 34 conceded. That all adds up to the championship. Chick Bates, Lou Macari, Peter Henderson getting in on the act too. Some hijinks in the Stoke camp. Slowly they make their way around the Victoria Ground, and Vince Overson holding the trophy that means so much. And I really hope you've enjoyed this celebration of a championship season. Let's hope it's not 30 more years before we have another.